Hi, everybody. Matt Polka here with the American Cable Association here on Cable Talk, your podcast from ACA. Hey, listen, we would love for you to subscribe to our new podcast. You can stream and download Cable Talk from the iTunes podcast store, or you can find it on The Hub, which is a new section of our American Cable Association website at americancable.org/The Hub. Thanks for listening. Now let's get on with the show. Thanks again, everybody. We're here in another episode of Cable Talk brought to you by ACA, and we are very pleased today to have Brad Swanson, president of Florida Internet and Television, with us today. Brad, great to have you with us.
Hey, thanks, Matt. Great to be on the show.
We are really thrilled to spend some time with you. I had the chance to meet you here in the last year, but you're rather new to our industry. Tell us a little bit about how you got into the cable industry and more specifically the association business.
Sure. So, look, before I begin, I just can't compliment you enough. ACA is certainly on the vanguard line of protecting our members and members across the country. So thanks for everything that you and your team does every day in D.C. for providers across the country. So, all right. So how did I get into this industry? I've been in the association business for about 18 years, and I was mostly in the Chamber of Commerce world. I worked for the State Association for about 7 years, and when I did that, one of my key roles was organizing statewide coalitions and working with all of our C-suite major contributors, and of course in Florida, Charter Communications, formerly Bright House at the time, and Comcast were two of those significant members. And so I had built relationships with those two companies all the while looking at the association business, trying to think, how can we reach legislators and our members more from a more relevant platform? And so I actually built a a digital production program which would record both legislators and issues and help us get our message out in a visual format. And so it was the combination of knowing the Charter and Comcast folks and doing that granted me an application at the time of where applicants were putting in for this post in Florida. My predecessor had served for 29 years and he'd retired. And so it was during their search that I was invited to apply. So that's how I started.
Well, it's great to have you in the industry, and thanks for your kind words. I can say the same as well, because I'm seeing many of the new things that you're doing. But let's be honest, you have some additional experience and background here within at least the television or the movie industry. So why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
Okay. All right. So this one's the fun one for the cocktail receptions when anybody that's listening can we can catch up in D.C. So I grew up in a really interesting environment. My father was a film producer, production manager. So we spent our time between Los Angeles, of course, and my dad played a big role in building the South Florida film business. So everything from Gentle Ben to gave Burt Reynolds his one of his first acting jobs ever on Gentle Ben, and he did everything from Rocky to Caddyshack to My Father the Hero to Witness, Hellfighters with John Wayne. I mean, his career spanned the 60s through the early 2000s, and so it was a very creative environment growing up. So I grew up, you know, around a business model where you had 150 creative people coming together to make a product. And then my dad sat at that nexus of the creation of the product and managing that project to delivering it to market in a profitable format. So he was kind of both the creative and the heavy all in one.
Had to be fascinating to grow up with. And we're going to change the title of the podcast from Cable Talk to Movie Talk, because I'm a huge movie fan. So maybe we'll
do that. Anytime you want to talk movies.
There you go, our next iteration of Cable Talk for sure.
Love to.
But no doubt the experience that you gained around your family as well as in business has really led you to a point now where leading the Florida Association, even for a short time, you've engaged in quite the makeover, where you've changed the name of the association, you've updated your website, you've done a lot of rebranding. Tell us a little bit about that and some of the background for it and what you're seeing so far in terms of results.
Sure. So the first thing I would want, you know, anybody looking at the Florida model to know is we did it because the mission really called for it, right? So if you've known me for 5 seconds, you know I am a monastic missionary, if you will. I am all about the fight for free enterprise for our industry, and in my previous role, certainly for the Chamber of Commerce with all the business community folks involved in that. So everything that I've done when it comes to association work in my past all had to be ultra mission focused. I mean, there's not an image that we produce that doesn't have a goal and a purpose behind it. So when I came into the association, the industry had just gone through one of its recent changes, and my mandate from my board was to get our brand in alignment with where the corporate members of our association already were, because our legislative brand was sitting in places where a lot of industry brands sit across the country, which is a cable and a telecommunications provider. Excuse me, we're laying carpet in our offices as we speak, so forgive me. And so what is that brand? That brand is an ultra modern company that provides streaming and internet technology and cable technology across multiple platforms, and delivering some of the most enjoyable product that people consume every day. And so high tech, huge economic investment in the state, a huge stakeholder from employment in the state of Florida. And so to carry that brand with a model that reflects the industry, that was the end goal, so that we would walk out of the door with a product that we would brand to our legislator, which reflected who we already were. And so when we took on that task, we looked at everything we had, which was what the industry, you know, the roots of the industry, right? We started out as a cable industry that dug trenches and laid cable and started with Key West and added pods of industry players and then suddenly triple play and the whole thing. And, you know, it's the story you've lived, Matt, and you and everybody in this industry. But for me, you know, I came at it from the retail consumer side, going, man, I get to enjoy all this amazing streaming technology that comes out of my remote control, and it's clearly magic, right? And so the story I had to tell by updating our website was, no, it doesn't happen by magic. It happens by a lot of hard work and the grit and grizzle of digging trenches, laying cable, making sure this ultra complex network that when people think they've got computer issues inside their office network, small or large businesses, well, we have to do that over miles and miles and miles of our distributed network. And ours is not less complex. It's way more complex than those offices are typically running on. So, and we got to facilitate billions of dollars of commerce in every state by the very businesses we hook up. So, so that was the reason. And so the brand that you see now, when you go onto our website, it's no coincidence that we've mirrored you guys and our other friends down the street at NCTA and frankly, you know, our big and small members across the board.
Sure.
To, you know, talk about, you know, everything that this industry delivers. I mean, the IoT is one of the most beautiful and sexiest toys that we see in this industry, but our industry and our people are so focused on the networks we build because that's what makes them tick that we forget the end user wants to make sure the IoT device works or their tablet works, that they can see the images that they want to pull through the tablet. And it's only by connecting the two that we can tell the full story of our industry. Essentially, you want to show them the bait in the sizzle that sells the steak, if you will.
So. Absolutely. Well, that's terrific. And you're right. It takes a lot of innovation, investment, commitment, capital expenditures, and a lot of hard work, which sometimes policymakers don't really appreciate. And it's really our job to help convey that, whether on the state or the national level. So thanks for that. And we do our best to follow all that you're doing, as well as others in the industry. And we're definitely learning from each other. Let's switch to some policy issues briefly. You know, this is by far, in my view, one of the most contentious political and policy years ever that certainly I've been associated with since I started working in Washington since 93. But, you know, politics and the politicization of issues is certainly par for the course no matter where you go. What's it like in your state today? What are some of the key issues that you're dealing with in Florida right now? And what are some of the issues that are before you?
You know, I got to say, in Florida, we're feeling blessed right now. And my counterparts across this country are literally street fighting on all these federal issues that are finding their way into state level politics, everything from privacy to net neutrality to you name the federal issues that now you're seeing state level approaches or state level bills filed, which obviously, as we know, is a nightmare to think that you're going to have, you know, if you drive from, you know, New York to Florida, you're going to have what, 18 different, privacy agreements that you're gonna have to click as you're, you know, yep, sitting in that car. That's just at a least nightmare, and it's untenable. So in Florida, we sit in a really good posture. We have a very pro-business legislature, and about 12 years ago, the industry and the legislature decided to deregulate our industry. So we don't have block-to-block franchise issues. We have statewide franchises here in Florida, and we have a communication service tax model that allows both our industry and our similar technology platform industries like the telecoms, et cetera, where we're typically all walking to a larger degree in alignment on our policy. And where we see the big issues that come up are mission creep from, you know, folks that say, well, of course your PSC, you know, should regulate this. No, we deregulated, and we're a private, in an ultra private and ultra competitive marketplace across Florida. So the customers get to choose, and they get to make that choice every day by choosing. Unlike, you know, markets where they don't get choice. And in our major metropolitan markets, you know, customers have sometimes up to 4 to 6 choices in who they get an internet stream from, a cable feed from. And so that model is working in Florida, and we've been making that model and fighting to continue to make that model work in Florida, because we feel it both works amazingly for our companies and our members, and it also ultimately drives the top value to the consumer, which is the number one goal of the game. So,
well, that's a great situation to be in, and we certainly appreciate it, knowing the fact that we have quite a few members in Florida as well that work with you, and we're seeing the great things that they're doing. So good for you.
Yeah, Matt, let me give one caveat. So those federal issues, we have absolutely engaged in the national coalitions on making sure we're arguing for net neutrality. But we all know in our industry, we've always been for
absolutely
having a free and open internet. The trick is we're informing those folks across Florida who may have you know, been fed, you know, a line, if you will, and we're out there, you know, correcting the record with the facts that a light regulatory touch since 1996 has been the best thing for, you know, the growth of the internet that really the world's ever seen. So
there's no question about that when you look at the billions of dollars that have literally been invested in the ground and on the poles to deliver internet services to customers today that they just basically take for granted.
Yeah,
but at the same time, you know, there's this movement, which I think is based on disinformation about we as internet service providers that are trying to block or limit or discriminate against users. And frankly, it's a very, very difficult thing to fight against, certainly on the federal level and on the state level in many states. A lot of this comes down to relationships that our member companies, that your member companies have with their federal and state legislators, as well as how you mm-hmm. connect from your association with your state lawmakers. Tell us a little bit about what you do to encourage your members to build solid relationships with their legislators in Florida, and some of the things that you do at the association to better connect with your lawmakers.
Sure. Well, it all starts, obviously, with having ultra high ethics and high integrity, and having everybody on your team you know, come from that bolt of cloth in this process. It takes one bad apple to, you know, send a group of legislators down the wrong path with perception. So, you know, both myself and our entire team, we work hand in hand with both our members and their lobbyists as well in our process. So we really lever the entirety of our industry and our and the lobbyists in our industry to work together in a united front. And so that combined approach with the continuous relationships and being a resource for all of the legislators, new and old, is important. So we do that in two key ways beyond just what we know is traditional relationship building and maintenance. Is our freshman legislators in our state, and again, every state's a little different with how their ethics laws work, but we train incoming freshmen. We do immediate training for the incoming freshmen, Democrats, senators, Democrats and Republican House members. And we do it, obviously, you know, in those four separate groups. And we'll do immediate training. We, in kind of, you know, we do it as part of our political giving to the parties. But we'll do a full-blown media training for these folks, makeup, how to handle crisis media, you know, when the reporter and the camera lights flip the light on as you're walking from your committee back to your office, what do you do? And what we found, and that wasn't what I invented. Our association has done that for a very long time. And what we found is we become a resource for these members as they grow in leadership to call us up and go, hey, I'm getting ready for a tough conversation. You know, Brad, you know, what do you think we should do? And I found myself in the short 18 months I've been here having those conversations all the time. The second thing we do is our members have long been a part of publishing a television show, producing and creating a public affairs show, formerly used to be called Capital Insight. And now we've rebranded that as Fi TV, because obviously versus the 5G sure. brand that our friends in telecom use. And we interview legislators, we interview thought leaders of leading business associations and associations in general across the state that both have the ear of leadership and legislators. And then we'll interview relevant parties that might address issues that are important to the members in our industry. But it's that vehicle of the interviews of our digital show. Now, we do have a great partnership with Fox, where they broadcast that show every week, Tuesday mornings, I think it's at 7:30, statewide. Nice. But really our goal is to blast those digital shows into the legislative influential realm, which, you know, with your electeds, their staff, and the players that play in the game, it's about a 2,000 to 5,000 person audience. So we can geofence, geotarget, use all the tools that social media afford, the internet, should I say, afford.
Right.
And we use the tools that we bring to everyone every day for to inform legislators about how best to keep promoting this tool that empowers the smallest business person in the state or the largest, you know, economic drivers, corporate economic drivers. So that's what we do and how we do it.
I've seen it, and it's awesome. It really is a great way to connect with lawmakers, and it's no wonder that you get such a great response from your lawmakers. So good for you.
Well, let me plug it. It's Twitter. It's the Twitter. The Facebook handles are at FL Internet TV. So if your members see it and they want to ask us any questions, please let them know. I'm always available to tell folks, you know, share with folks how we do it. And obviously we don't have the corner of the market on good ideas. So if they've got better ideas, you know, I always like hearing those too.
Oh, that's great. Thanks for sharing that with us. Hey, I've got sure. one more question for you here before we wrap up today.
Yep.
This is certainly each and every day when we turn on our computers, I was going to say read a newspaper, but not many of us do that as much as we used to.
We do it on our computers.
So. Right. We turn on our computers and we see the headlines and we realize how dynamic of a changing industry we're working in each and every day. From your perspective, working with your members in Florida, what do you see as some of the key industry trends that your members need to really stay on top of to be successful in the future?
Well, you know, we're blessed with amazing and forward-thinking leaders. So I'd love to say, you know, we would give them something to stay on top of. But really, I'm just trying to keep up with the members' innovations in our marketplace and across
so
the country.
True.
It's like
so
every
true.
Day something breaks. But when it comes to things that we hear legislators that are influential in the process focusing on is it's the stuff that makes their life, the space age stuff that's actually already here. So all the Internet of Things devices, the 15 plugins and the bells and whistles that our industry make possible, consistently, when I remind them those things work because we have these robust networks, the aha moments go off. So if I had to encourage your members to do anything, it would be to consistently attach the hard work they do every day to that end user experience and remind them that good policy allows that end user experience to be that much better.
Well, you have really established yourself as a leader in that regard, and everyone, I think, in our industry is taking notice. We sure are.
So, well, I'm just trying to keep up with you, Matt.
Well, that's very kind. Well, we are looking forward to continuing to work with you. I know I had the chance last year to meet you at our 24th annual summit in Washington, D.C. Are you coming to Summit 25
here in a few short weeks? Yeah, I can't wait to be there. I learned so much from it, and I met so many of the key partner organizations, all the channel providers, all the people that build that amazing content that actually legislators associate with. They're all there. Everybody should go. I hope to see you there, and if anyone has questions for me and they see me there, please feel free to come up and engage me. I want to know more about what your members do across the country.
Well, we're looking forward to having you again and really enjoy spending some time together. And thank you for how open you've been to us at ACA and vice versa. I know you've had some of our staff members down to visit with you during your event last year, and we look forward to working with you in the year ahead. So Brad Swanson, president of Florida Internet and Television, thanks for being with us here today.
Well, thanks, Matt, and nobody's doing more than ACA, so we appreciate you. Keep up the great work.
Vice versa. And everybody, thanks for joining us again for another edition of ACA's Cable Talk. Don't forget, you can find us on iTunes, stream or download Cable Talk from iTunes or The Hub, which is a new part of our website at americancable.org/The Hub. And make sure to share with your friends about Cable Talk. We'd love to hear more from you with your feedback and what other stories we can cover for you as we go on. So, Brad, thanks again. And everybody, thanks for being here. We'll see you next time on ACA's Cable Talk.